So good evening, everyone. We had met yesterday and we have been like in practicing session for past 15 minutes, but now it's the official time. So this is December and I think we had a very bittersweet year. Doctors like enjoyed also, they went through panic phase of COVID and then they went through accepting phase. Similarly, we are at the end of WDW tenure. This tenure lasted for 2 years and it was indeed a holistic satiate to all our senses, I believe, all those who had participated in it. And there was a desire to get better, all the activities which we did in this. The aim was to be a giver and to quench the perpetual thirst for fun and enjoyment. And we did all and had it all, I believe. IMBWD was a brainchild of IME, started in May 2018 with clear delineated motives and path. The aims were to educate and education and enhancement of women doctor and increase their participation in IMA activities. Somehow women have always lagged behind in IMA activity. That was the main purpose for this. Mishraji, slide number six. Yes. For this program, we did lots of health and personality development related program, financial management workshop, program on computer and smartphone usage, self-defense and spirituality workshops were also conducted. Besides this, being a woman doctors, we are at the apex of the pyramid of women education and empowerment. WDW was given the task to promote health vaccination awareness in society. We had educational program or parenting classes on sexual education, menstrual hygiene, self-defense and substance abuse for betterment of society. Many schools and villages were covered with our motives. Hope they would serve as start for coming WDW tenures. In fact, it's going to get better because now even more energetic people are going to become leaders of this organization. I also welcome Dr. Chitra Jain Madam and Dr. Sonal Richaria, who is the secretary, and Dr. Chitra Jain Madam is the new chairperson. I'll welcome the main force behind the activities for past 2 years. Can anyone guess who is she? She is the planner, the motivator, the manipulator, and the coercer for me. She always keeps on pushing me. Yeah, and she is very meticulous with her planning. It sends me into depression, actually, when I see what all she has, like minuscule details she takes care of. She's none other than us, Dr. Sangeeta Srivastava, Madam. I welcome you. You are like a mentor to me. I would request you to say a few words and share the glimpses of our tenure.
Hello, friends. At the outset, let me welcome you all to this wonderful medico-legal webinar, which we have arranged with great difficulty after postponing many times. Let me take you through the journey of my 2 years of this IMA WDW, glimpses of what we did during these 2 years. I would like to play a small video, and we have tried to cover whatever we have done during these 2 years.
Good evening to one and all. At the outset, let me welcome you all to this very important webinar on medico-legal update today. It's with great humility I stand before you as we have come to the end of this year 2020, which has been a mind-boggling time for each one of us. Nevertheless, our lives kept on going, and so did IMA Women Doctors Week. I am here about to end my tenure of 2 years as the chairperson of IMA WDW, and I am overwhelmed and filled with emotions and pride to sum up the work done, and would love to take you down the memory lane. We started our journey in 2018 July, immediately after IMA WDW was formed at the headquarters, with a full bang, keeping in mind the guidelines given to us by the national headquarters. Initially, we focused on various programs with the theme Mission Pink Health. We organized various hemoglobin camps and anemia detection camps with the help of our members at various locations. We conducted many awareness programs and adolescent education programs in various schools and colleges. I must confess, it wouldn't have been possible without the support of you all, my dear friends and members, who have been actively supporting me throughout my tenure. We also conducted various rallies for sensitization issues like Save the Girl Child, organ donation, etc. We have some lovely memories of learning Garbha in our IMA hall from the experts, after which we successfully arranged IMA Garbha during the Navratri, and the program was a huge success. Then, during Sankranti, we conducted Urjita Fun Fair. The prime intention was to promote the hidden talent of our members, promote small-scale business and women empowerment. It started with a thought and turned out to be an extremely successful activity. It gave platform to many women and promoted them and gave us a new relationship which we cherish till date. We also had a wonderful program on financial management on Women's Day, where we invited an entire financial management team TLR from Bangalore, headed by Mr. Saushtav Chakravarti and Mr. Mayank Saxena, who gave us great insight into how to manage finances in various aspects which we females most of the times are quite ignorant of. The program was followed by a cooking competition. In one of our programs, we invited experts to learn the skills and technicalities of smartphones and computer usage. Our most successful program was a two-day multidimensional, multidisciplinary workshop, Urjita, a complete program on personality development, grooming, women wellness, and fashion. We had sessions on yoga, zumba, and fitness by trained professionals like Dr. Deepa Tiwari and Sumit Sir. Mrs. Rita Gangwani, who is an international grooming coach and motivational speaker from Delhi, enlightened us on many topics. We had Mrs. Namrata Gupta, a famous psychologist from Delhi, who spoke on organizational behavior and relationships. We had Mrs. Preeti Kumar, a famous figure of our city, who heads the Satyaprakash Finishing School. She spoke on social graces, deportment etiquettes and table manners. We had Mrs. Smriti Chaturvedi, dietitian from Jaipur, who spoke on healthy eating and weight reduction. We had a session on anti-aging by Dr. Parimal Swami. And a complete session on makeup and sari draping by the beautician. We conducted a self-defense workshop by Mr. Vishwajit from Talwalkar's Mumbai. In the evening, we had a magnificent fashion show by our very talented and beautiful IMAWDW members. In the winters December last year, we had an entire sports event, IMA Olympics, where we conducted all types of indoor and outdoor sports for women and children of IMAWDW. In the summer, we celebrated Family Day by arranging cultural activity by our members and their children. These are the memories revisited, and my time as a chairperson turned out to be quite useful and satisfactory. This journey taught me that the only thing that matters is smile and confidence. As I come to the end of this tenure, I am so glad to pass on this baton to a very talented and deserving person, Dr. Chitra Jain Ma'am, who I am sure will raise the bars and give her best. Wishing you all the success, ma'am. Also, this journey would be incomplete if I do not thank my entire team, especially Dr. Neetu Yadav, who has been my pillar of strength always, and special thanks to Dr. Shruti Agarwal, Dr. Prachi Saxena, Dr. Pradnya Harsey, Dr. Neena Srivastav, Dr. Richa Dhiravani, Dr. Arshna Srivastav, Dr. Kavita Singh, and entire team Jogs for helping me whenever I needed them. I am highly obliged to all of you, without whom this journey would be incomplete. At the end, I would just say, हम अकेले ही चले थे राह मंजिल की ओर, लोग जुड़ते गए और कारवां बनता गया. No matter where you are in life, inspire and empower the women around you. Success is never achieved alone, and wisdom and wealth are sweeter when shared. Thank you.
Once again, thanking each one of you, I would once again like to thank the entire JOGS team, especially Dr. Alka Agarwal Madam and Dr. Anuradha Dang, without which my working of IMAWDW would have been difficult. I would also like to thank Dr. Pradnya Dhiravani, who is behind the curtain. She acts like a backbone to me, and she is always there in each and every activity of mine. Thank you, ma'am, for being with me always. During this corona times, IMAWDW also did many social works, like supplying a mask to the Nagar Nigam people and the poor people, then supplying PPE kits to the government organizations like Elgin, and encouraging the corona workers by felicitating the doctors and the police person. At the end, I would just say that we wanted to end this our tenure with a very good program, and nothing came to my mind. I just thought for few months and thought that which program could be impressive for each one of you, each department, and then the medico-legal subject came to my mind. Since 2 months, I was trying to arrange this workshop, and Dr. Geeta Goin really helped me to arrange it. We tried to postpone this program every time hurdles came, and we at last we have now arrived to the program, and today we are here. And I thank Geeta Goin Madam for helping me to arrange this program. Thank you, Geeta Ma'am. And now I would like to welcome our guest of honor, Dr. Mona Desai Madam. Nobody else could be a better guest for this program, because we are at the end of this tenure, and Madam Mona Desai is the national president of IMAWDW, and I am highly obliged, ma'am, for accepting our invitation at the last moment. And you are just an inspirational figure for us. We have really been fortunate to have you today for this program. Madam is a practicing pediatrician and neonatologist since 32 years. She at present is the national chairperson of IMAWDW, and the chairperson of Gujarat State WDW, chairperson of IMA Ahmedabad WDW, immediate past president of IMA Ahmedabad, and the first lady, postgraduate lady doctor president in 118 years of history of AMA for the year 2019 and 2020. And she has, she is the member of executive committee of CIMMAO and SARS Nations. She has won various awards, and she has adopted 1,000 children of four municipal schools and goes for regular health checkups and free medicines. And she has received the Corona Warrior Award from IMA headquarters for the year 2020, ma'am. I welcome you, ma'am, for this program. We are very fortunate to have you here, and we would like, we would love to have a few words from you.
Thank you, Dr. Sangeeta, first of all, for giving me a chance to talk to you all lovely ladies, very vibrant ladies, and few males whom I can see on the Zoom. Yes, Dr. Sangeeta, I just saw your journey of 2 years. You were very right. अकेले ही चलते गए और लोग इकट्ठे होते रहे और कारवा बनता गया. The same thing has been true for our women doctors wing, because our standing committee of women doctors has been in existence since the day IMA came into existence. But unfortunately, whoever became the chairperson of that standing committee, nothing really happened to the for women doctors. And fortunately, when I became the chairperson of women standing committee of women doctors, I realized that this is a wonderful opportunity to encourage and inspire all women doctors, because it is not that we don't have the capacity to work. It is just that we need somebody to pull us out of that comfort zone. And then I think rest is the history, and you have seen how well everybody is working in the women doctors wing. And from standing committee, I have been so fortunate that we have been given the status of a wing. So now we are an individual wing of IMA, and I think this all credit goes to all of us ladies who have worked very hard for last 2 years. And in 2018, we got the award of the best wing. And even I think everybody would believe and agree to this, that our women doctors wing at present is the most active wing in IMA. And we have been doing wonderful work before Corona period and during the Corona pandemic also. And in few of your programs which you narrated, I was very happy when you said you people learned Garba and then had a Garba function, because I am from Gujarat and I am from Ahmedabad, and it is a hub for Garbas. And I think that is very dear and near to my heart. And congratulations to you. I am looking at your wonderful photographs, wearing and adorning that beautiful Garba dresses. You all look beautiful. You had wonderful programs so well that it would increase and enhance the personality of each woman. And I'm so happy that you have such a strong team. Dr. Neetu, as your secretary, she is also very active and vibrant. And I'm sure one person cannot make a symphony. You need the whole orchestra. So for your symphony, you had a wonderful, vibrant orchestra who was very active. And I would say you've been lucky these 2 years that you could do this such wonderful programs. I'm sure if it wasn't Corona for us for these 10 months, we would have done much, much better. Now, before I end my speech, I just want to speak few words for mixopathy. We all women doctors, you all know that our IMA now, we are all fighting against mixopathy. The CCIM and the Niti Aayog has brought this amendment. They have modified the amendment, and they have brought this into existence that the postgraduate studies of two of the branches of Ayurveda, that is Shalakya and Shailya, that is one is of general surgery and one is of head and neck surgeries. They will be given a training mixed with their Ayurveda of modern medicine. And at the end, when they become postgraduate doctors, they will be allowed to do 58 kind of surgeries. Now it is, I don't know, it is something beyond all of us that how a single person can even perform cataract surgeries and can even do skin grafting and can also do anastomosis of intestine. I think he must be super genius if these Ayurved people, if you think about it. So I think we have to fight tooth and nail against it. One good news, I would say, okay, one news are that now even dental society, dental people have joined us because this Niti Aayog and CCIM has also include dental surgeries for these Ayurvedas. So we are lucky to have now dentists also with us. So I think that would make us more strong. I have sent you a questionnaire. I think I have sent to Sangeeta ji. And Sangeeta, I would love that you would just spread it to the social media and give it to all your lady doctors. You must be having a Facebook. And I want that we should have a very strong public opinion. And we should make public understand what we are fighting for. What is mixopathy? And why it is against it? Because it is their health which is at stake. This kind of khichrified doctors are going to spoil their health. And our whole health system would be, I would say, in real danger if mixopathy comes. So we have to fight now, and it's a war, and it has to be now or never. So with this, I'm sure you all will really support IMA headquarters, because in good times, we are there to support them. But in such kind of fights, we have to be very strong and fight, you know, against IMA, against mixopathy, with IMA, of course, because we are a part of Indian Medical Association and very strong part of Indian Medical Association, because they say that 50% of members of Indian Medical Association are women doctors. So we are a very strong part, and I'm sure we are going to fight real well. Once again, congratulations to Dr. Sangeeta. You've done a lovely work, to Dr. Neetu also. And again, my all the best and best wishes to the incoming president or the incoming chairperson, Dr. Chitra. Any help you need from us, we are always there from the national team. Dr. Neeta Biyani and myself, we are there to help you out. And to all you beautiful ladies, I'm sure you're going to work better and better. And Dr. Sangeeta, I would love if you will still remain very active, because we need all active people here in Women Doctors Wing to take it to a greater height. So once again, thank you so much for giving me this opportunity and organizing this wonderful webinar on medico-legal subject, because this is a subject which is need of this hour. And we all have to understand this, because day by day, violence against doctors are increasing. So we got to know everything about medico-legal aspect. So over to you, Dr. Sangeeta. And once again, thank you and namaste.
Thank you, madam, for gracing our program. We are very happy to have you today. And we will always be there with you. I'll be there and helping as a helping hand to Chitra ma'am always. And the link you have sent, I'll be sending it to everybody, each and every member of IMA plus IMA WDW, so that everybody can respond back and give their feedback, so that we have many more people to fight against this mixopathy. And I think we'll be able to do as much as we can. Neetu, now I think we should start this program. Madam, thank you once again for being with us for this program. And over to you, Neetu.
So now we'll start for which we have assembled the CME. So our first speaker would be the person who have actually joined, probably among the first people who have joined, Dr. Neeraj Nagpal sir. I'll request our chairperson, Dr. Swaraj Nayak madam, and Dr. Alpana Chawla, to join. I would just like to give a short introduction of our chairperson, Dr. Alpana Chawla. Madam is my senior. Actually, we both are pediatrician. She's a very well-known senior pediatrician of our city. She has served the Jabalpur Academy of Pediatrics as secretary and as president for many years. And she, even when she was not at post, she has helped us in doing many of academic activities. And Dr. Swaraj Nayak, madam, she is a senior obs and gyne practitioner, and she is the head of Nayak Nursing Home. She has been a past president of Jabalpur Association of Obs and Gynecologists and has won national prize for the best branch and a Dr. D.K. Tank Award. Presently, she is president of Jabalpur Menopause Society. Madam has been faculty to many national conferences. Welcome, ma'am. I would request Dr. Swaraj Nayak, madam, to introduce Dr. Neeraj Nakpa, sir.
Good evening, also, sir, everyone. I hope I'm heard.
Yes,
can you
ma'am.
Hear me?
You're on.
Thank you so much, Neetu. It's my privilege to introduce Dr. Neeraj Nakpal once again, sir. And as we all know that medical profession is considered to be the most noble profession out of all. This puts more responsibility on our shoulders as we are concerning with the life of patient. As an obstetrician, rather, we are concerned with two lives. Hence, we are required to keep ourselves updated with the latest. At the same time, we have to balance ethical and legal obligations. In medical practice, most of us, or in fact, all of us in this current scenario would come across medical legal litigation. Hence, all doctors should be well acquainted about the existing guidelines and the laws concerning us when we are dealing with these medical legal cases. In this context, I would like to invite Dr. Neeraj Nakpal, who is an eminent speaker, eminent writer, RTI activist, and besides, he is chairman and managing trustee of Medico Legal Action Group. He is ex-president IMA Chandigarh State Branch and director of Hope Gastrointestinal Diagnostic Clinic Chandigarh. He is a pioneer gastroenterologist endoscopist. So I welcome you, sir, for your talk. And once again, I want to congratulate you because yesterday also I had this, I was privileged to introduce you and it was very fantastic to hear you. I hope my today's audience will also enjoy your talk. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I need to share my screen. So, okay. Thank you, IMA Women Doctors Wing, for having considered me to deliver this talk. I think this was more than 3 months overdue. We had discussed this to do this around 3 months ago, and I think for some reason this was delayed. But anyway, so I'll go straight to the topic which has been given to me, which is Consumer Protection Act 2019 and its implications for doctors. Some people recently asked me to speak on the recent amendments in CPA. And this is what I want to stress, that there are no recent amendments which have been made in Consumer Protection Act. The Consumer Protection Act 1986 has been totally repealed, and a new Consumer Protection Act has been notified. This was passed by the Lok Sabha on 30th July 2019, by the Rajya Sabha on 6th August 2019. Notification was dated 15th July 2020, and it was applicable from 20th July 2020. So as of 20th July 2020, there is a new Consumer Protection Act, which is in place, which has nothing to do with the previous act. The moment this act was passed, for some reason, doctors, groups in social media suddenly erupted in joy that doctors have been removed from the purview of Consumer Protection Act. This needs to be tempered immediately, because by now most of you would have realized that we are still covered under Consumer Protection Act. Unless and until we go to court, in court, by court I mean the Supreme Court, to get a decision on this issue. Why the confusion arose? Because in the draft bill, healthcare was included, and publicly the Minister of Consumer Affairs in Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha declared that healthcare is going to be dropped from the bill, and it was dropped from the list of services in the final bill which was passed. So his speech in Rajya Sabha and the news items which followed created a confusion. There is a literal interpretation which people had taken of this Section 2 of Consumer Protection Act. I'll come to that. We all wanted healthcare to be removed, so we tried to believe what we all wanted, and we selectively read the law. But what was the law? The law said very clearly that save as otherwise expressly provided by the central government by notification, this act shall apply to all goods and services. So effectively, all goods and services are covered unless there is a specific notification which excludes a particular kind of services. And since Consumer Protection Act 2019 does not give any such exclusion, hence, by implication, healthcare is included in the list of services. And in the definition of services, this is where the confusion arose, because in the draft bill, healthcare was included in this, and that healthcare word was dropped. But if you read the Section 2 carefully, it says very clearly, services of any description which is made available to potential users and includes but is not limited to the following examples of banking, finance, insurance, etc., etc. And in this list, healthcare was dropped. So effectively, it says very clearly, it includes these services, but it is not limited to these services. So other services are also included, with unless and until it is specifically an exclusion is given. And when the rules came, another nail in our coffin was stuck, where it said very clearly that matters relating to proceedings in respect of medical negligence resulting in grievous injury or death shall not be referred for mediation. Mediation and arbitration is a new aspect of the Consumer Protection Act 2019, probably the only good aspect about Consumer Protection Act 2019 where doctors are concerned. And in this, cases of grievous injury or death because of medical negligence cannot be referred to. So once this is mentioned in the rules, the question whether medical negligence is included under Consumer Protection Act or healthcare services are included becomes redundant. You have to realize that Consumer Protection Act 1986 was 31 sections only. And the CPA 2019 is a voluminous law with 107 sections. Even with all the amendments which came in CPA 1986, it came only up to, including all the subsections, to around 48. And Section 100 of the new 2019 Act says very clearly, this was also there in 1986, that the provisions of this Act shall be in addition to and not in derogation of provisions of any other law for the time being in force. Effectively, what does this mean? You can be hauled up to consumer courts. Yes, all of us know that. All of us have been dragged. But simultaneously, you can also be hauled up in the same case to your state medical council. A complaint can be made to your hospital authorities. They will conduct an inquiry. A police complaint can be given. They will conduct an inquiry. Complaint may be marked to DC or civil surgeon, who will conduct their own inquiry. Complaint to authority under Clinical Establishment Act, they will conduct their own inquiry. Complaint to Chief Minister, Prime Minister, who can decide wherever the inquiry is to be conducted. A complaint may be made to NABH, JCI, any of the accrediting organizations. This has happened in case of Alchemist Hospital in Panchkula after death of a patient. the complaint was made to NABH, why have you given your certification to this hospital? This is the kind of hospital which does these kind of negligence cases. Complaint to Central Consumer Protection Authority. This is something which we all need to understand very clearly. We will be focusing to some extent on this issue in this lecture also. But this is something which is new in Consumer Protection Act 2019. And this is something which is very draconian. Complaints are also made to ECHS, Ayushman Bharat, CGHS authorities for hospitals or doctors who are empaneled with this. NRI cell, women's cell, SCST commission, there also complaints are made, and all these can carry on simultaneously along with the Consumer Protection Act. What cannot go along with the Consumer Protection Act is cases cannot be filed for a civil suit for compensation under tort. So a civil litigation cannot be started along with a consumer court case. Similarly, National or State Human Rights Commission, if you are approaching, you will probably not be going through Consumer Protection Act also. High Court, Supreme Court, if a complaint is to be lodged for a violation of your fundamental rights, because right to health today is under Article 21, fundamental right. And if a patient who is being treated in a government hospital, treated free of cost, wishes to sue the hospital or the government, this is the place where they go, but then they cannot also simultaneously go to consumer courts. Look at this example, Command Hospital, where was involved, doctor and nurse was involved, patient was an ECHS patient, mother of one of the serving people. She was a known case of carcinoma ovary, developed renal failure after being given cisplatin instead of carboplatin. Later she died. The hospital held an internal inquiry, punished the staff nurse in charge of the ward, administrative punishment, and the court awarded 10 lakhs compensation and divided the compensation between the nurse, the doctor, and the hospital. Why I brought this example, this is one reason is it is one of the latest cases. Second reason is people do not realize that even command hospital, even army hospitals can be sued under Consumer Protection Act. This is a very, very important issue which needs to be realized from this. And NCDRC, this is National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission, had asked for an opinion of Medical Board of AIIMS, which said that a single dose should not routinely cause renal failure, despite that this was considered negligence. The service of the hospital, the judgment said very clearly, would be treated as covered under Section 2 of Consumer Protection Act 1986. And therefore, we find that the complaint is maintainable. They have given the judgment after the notification of 2019, but since the case was filed when Consumer Protection Act 1986 was vogue, at that time, the decision covered it under the CPA 1986. So this is important to understand that nurses can be, compensation can be awarded against nurses. We have many cases, I'm not going to go into all of them. Just one I wanted to show because this gives a very clear message. Similarly, Sudhakar versus Union of India, but this was under Article 226 or Article 32 in High Court. This was not in Consumer Court. The army doctors were sued in High Court and 12.5 lakhs compensation was awarded. Now, Section 34 of the CPA 2019 decided that the pecuniary jurisdiction, what was the pecuniary jurisdiction between district, state and national commission? Earlier in 1986, when it first came, it was 5 lakhs for district, 20 lakhs for state and 1 CR for national, above 20 lakhs for national. This was amended later, from 5 it became 20 lakhs, so up to 20 lakhs cases would go to district commission, from 20 to 1 CR to state commission, and 1 CR and above used to go to national commission. But it was the compensation which has been asked for. It was not the value of goods or services paid. In 2019, what has been specified or changed is that how much the person has paid for the services is the deciding factor whether the case will be heard in district fora, state commission or national commission. Meaning to say, if a person has paid up to or less than 1 crore, whether it is 5 rupees or it is 99 lakhs, the case will come to the district court. This is something which has to be understood. How much compensation has been asked for, whether compensation asked for is 100 crores or it has asked for 500 rupees, the case will still come to district commission. Because the pecuniary jurisdiction under CPA 2019 now has put the onus on what has been charged for the services. Second thing is, where does where was the case being filed? Earlier, the case used to be filed in the place where cause of action occurs or wherever the opposite party at the time of institution of the complaint ordinarily resided or carried on his business. If there were more than one opposite parties, any one of the opposite parties residing or carrying on business, that is the place where case used to be filed. Cause of action, of course, was the main place where this was more relevant, where person from Ahmedabad was referred to Delhi and some hospital in Ahmedabad treated, then they referred to Delhi, and Delhi also the treatment was given. So basically, it was the doctors or where they lived or where they worked, the case could be filed only there. In 2019, this is a major change which has come. The complainant resides or personally works for gain. That place is also where he can now file the complaint. Why is this is important? Surgery has been done in Delhi. Person belongs to Kerala, from a village in Kerala. He has now the legal sanction to file a case in his district in Kerala. And doctors will have to keep going to that place, to the district commission, to file the case. This is the kind of harassment which will be new under CPA 2019. There was a lot of issues and people were not ready to accept initially that what we were saying regarding the pecuniary jurisdiction was correct. But then Delhi State Commission, where a case was filed for more than one CR, and in the State Commission it was filed, and the advocate for the complainant said, since we are asking for more than one CR, we have come to you for adjudication. The court held that you have paid only 51,700 rupees for your services. And up to one CR, if you have paid for services, you have to go back to district commission. So judgment stated that as per section 47 of CPA 2019, the pecuniary jurisdiction of state commission is only when the value of goods and services paid as consideration exceeds one CR, case was dismissed, with freedom to file a case in the appropriate district commission. Then each district, the 1986 CPA had said, the person who will be, shall consist of a person who is or has been or is qualified to be a district judge. He only can be president. This was written in the act. CPA 2019 removed the qualification of the president from the act. They said the state government shall establish a district commission in each district. Each district commission shall consist of a president, not less than two and not more than four such number of members as may be prescribed in consultation with central government. What did this mean? The qualification of the district forum president was left to the executive, to the executive branch to decide what will be the qualification. Effectively, it took away the powers of the commission, because now they were to be selected or appointed by the executive. So their own judicial independence has been taken away in CPA 2019. In the rules, they brought back the thing that the president has to be have been a judge of the High Court, or the president has to have been a judge of the district court. But as I said, rules is a subordinate legislation. Act is the predominant legislation. And rules, a subordinate legislation, cannot expand or cannot be used to explain what is meant in the act. An act can be used to explain or to describe the rules, but can't be vice versa. And the main issue here is rules are formed by the executive. The act is passed by the parliament. An act has to be supreme. So this judicial independence has been taken away to some extent in CPA 2019. Basically, in 1986, consumer was always the favored or pampered litigant in consumer courts. 2019, you should shudder to enter the hallowed precincts of consumer courts. There is no way you will get justice under this. E-filing of complaints is something which has been added in CPA 2019. We sit on our computer, we open Amazon, we order right, left and center without thinking. It is so easy. The same way now a patient who is disgruntled will be having that kind of ease in filing the e-complaints. If he has not paid more than 5 lakhs for the services, if you have charged him anywhere from 0 to 4,99,999, then under those circumstances, there is no fee which has to pay in the consumer courts. And he can e-file the complaint. Whereas, if I have to file an appeal, earlier it used to be I have to pay either 25,000 or 50% of the compensation awarded before I could take the case in appeal to State Commission. Now, I can take a case decision to, I can appeal a decision to State Commission only by depositing 50% of the compensation awarded. There is, the process of appeal has been made very much more difficult. As I said earlier, mediation as an alternate dispute redressal mechanism has been added in CPA 2019. The complaint will be referred by consumer commissions for mediation wherever scope for settlement exists and parties agree to it. Mediation cells to be established under consumer commissions, and there will be no appeal after settlement has been made through the mediation. So all the doctors, I have one request, do not go for out-of-court settlements any longer. Agree to whatever amount you have agreed to pay the person if you are wanting to settle, but pay that settlement through the arbitration cell of consumer courts or through Lok Adalat. Do not hand over money outside, under the table, over the table, whichever way. This is something which is very, very important. And anyway, medical negligence resulting in grievous injuries or death cannot be referred for arbitration. Product liability is another thing which has been added to deter providers from providing deficient services. This, I feel, is going to make medical treatment costly because product liability clause will increase the cost of disposables, will increase the cost of medical equipment, and the entire thing will come down ultimately to be paid for by the patients. E-commerce has been included within the ambit of Consumer Protection Act. This may be good for consumers otherwise, but for medical professionals and the healthcare system, I think this is going to create a lot many more problems. Compared to the previous act, there are certain things which have been unfair trade practice was already existent in 1986 act, but now failure to issue a bill or a receipt, refusal to accept a good return within 30 days and disclosure of personal information given in confidence unless required by law or in public interest all have been covered under unfair trade practice. What I do not understand is there is doctors do two kinds of practice. One is a prescription practice where consultants write down whatever medicine they have said. And the other is dispensing practice where they provide the medicine from their side. This refusal to accept a good return within 30 days, how this is going to affect the non-prescription practice where the dispensing practice is there, we have to wait and watch. Then this new thing which has come, the Consumer Protection Council's advisory nature was already existent in 1986. I will not waste time on that. The Consumer Dispute Redressal Commissions already were there. Only thing is the district forum is now named as district commission. What is new is Central Consumer Protection Authority with its employees, with the powers given to the employees. This is very, very draconian, and this is something I am most concerned about when I talk of CPA 2019. Who can file a complaint today under CPA 2019? The consumer, of course, can file. Any recognized consumer association can file. One or more consumers without being an association can file with the permission of the district commission, central government, central authority, or state government. Any one of them can also file. There have been certain rights of the consumers which have been notified. Then the Central Protection Councils, I already mentioned these are advisory, so I don't think these will have large bearing, but this is an additional constitutional authority, and 99% this is going to be filled with the political leftouts, people who do not get tickets, and because ultimately everything is by appointment, by nomination. So this is going to be a political reward of people who are regular workers in political parties. The CCPA is the most draconian thing which has come in, and this is something, as I've already mentioned two or three times, that what is I'm most concerned about. Why? The authority shall have an investigation being headed by a director general and any number of subordinates as may be prescribed for purpose of conducting an inquiry or investigation. When they are given powers to conduct an inquiry or investigation, you will have an investigation which is being conducted by the police. You will have an investigation which is now being conducted by the CCPA. District collector may inquire into or investigate complaints regarding violation. Once the local administration becomes part of a constitutional authority like this, my fear is we are in for a lot more trouble. And the central authority has certain issues why what it has to do. It has to protect, promote, enforce consumers. All looks very bland, but when you look at it from the eyes of the people who will be facing this, what I'm worried about will become apparent. It can cause an inquiry in itself. It can file complaints before district commission, state commission by itself, intervene in any proceedings before district commission, state commission, recommend adoption of best international practices on consumer rights, issue safety notices to alert consumers against dangerous or hazardous or unsafe goods. And on receiving a complaint or suo motu, it shall cause investigation to be made by the director general or by the district collector. They can order recalling of goods or withdrawal of services, reimbursement of the prices of goods or services, discontinuation of practices which are unfair, prejudicial to consumer interest. Can order to discontinue advertisement or to modify the same, impose on manufacturer or endorser a penalty which may extend to 10 lakh rupees for subsequent crime. 50 lakhs is the penalty which is awarded in this, which are powers they have. They may order to prohibit the endorser of a false or misleading advertisement from making endorsement of any product or service for a period which may extend to 1 year and for subsequent endorsement to 3 years. Whoever fails to comply with any direction of the central authority under sections 20 and 21 can be punished with an imprisonment which may extend to 6 months besides the fine, and if he does it in a subsequent year, subsequently again he does the same thing, then the imprisonment can be up to 2 years. I feel with this CPA 2019 and the other acts which we face when allegation of negligence is made, there is definite over-regulation in healthcare in India. Any appeal against the order of CCPA is to go to National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission. The central authority is vested with adjudicatory powers, including power to direct search, seizure, pass, seize, desist orders, even restrain endorsements. But the Act does not contain a prescription that its members should be drawn from areas of expertise in law. So basically, it has a judicial, totally judicial function, whereas the members may not be having judicial background. This is something which is anticipated to create some problems. Why 2019 is bad, CPA? Because I expect increase in number of cases filed for compensation due to ease of filing, because people will do e-filing, video conferencing. direct district commission filing for 99.99% cases because of the pecuniary jurisdiction, deemed admissibility of the complaint after 21 days of filing. If the patient has filed a complaint and the court has not had time to assess it, it will deem to be admitted. Then the person can sue from their hometown. No fear of penalty for frivolous complaint. In CPA 1986, there was a penalty, though it was a nominal one of 10,000 rupees, but at least it was there. In 2019, this has been done away with. And to file a complaint, no fee for services paid up to 5 lakhs, as I already mentioned. Exorbitant compensations being awarded is again my second fear. By increasing pecuniary jurisdiction of consumer commissions, the Act de facto accepts that compensations up to and about 10 crores can and should be asked for and awarded. We have to realize there was nearly a 2400% increase in litigation after BP Shanta and others versus Indian Medical Association in 1995. And with CPA 2019, I expect this to go up any amount of times. Section 89 is any manufacturer or service provider who causes or false misleading advertisement, as I have already mentioned, can have an imprisonment for a term which may extend to 2 years with a fine which may extend to 10 lakhs. For subsequent crime, the imprisonment can be up to 5 years and fine may extend to 50 lakhs. Then a product service provider shall be liable for in any product liability action if there is an act of omission or commission or negligence or withholding of any information which caused harm. This is something which will be used, the product liability will be used when we are disputing what is the consent. Again, this is too large a topic to fit in into a small time, so I will skip this. There is another concept of unfair contract which has been brought. Again, our consents will be challenged under this. As per Section 49 and 59 of CPA 2019, state and national commission shall have the power to declare any terms of contract which is unfair to any consumer to be null and void in the eyes of law. Second appeal to National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission cannot be made on the facts. It has to be made on a substantial question of law. Only if there is a substantial question of law involved, then only appeal can be filed from State Commission to National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission. But again, you have to see, except the President, other 4 to 11 members of the NCDRC may be technical or judicial. They need not be judicial. For non-judicial members to be deciding on substantial question of law, this is what the doctors have been asking for, doctors to be included in consumer protection in the benches of consumer commissions. But look at what is going to happen. We are saying substantial question of law is involved, only then appeal to National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission, where decision will be taken by non-judicial people. You know, on an issue which is a substantial question of law, not of facts. No other service provider has as many number of complaints filed against them as filed against doctors. Compensation of crores awarded against them, and we expect this too. The power of self-review has also been given to district, state, and national commission. They can do it suo moto. They can do it on an appeal by one of the parties. This is something which is new, which was not there. Certain sections of CPA 2019 have as yet not been notified, mainly the e-selling, the digital commerce. What is the solution for doctors? What should we do? One, any new case which is filed, we should, you can contact Medical Legal Action Group, you can contact Dr. Geetendra, you can contact Hitesh, anyone. The point is, we need to add a preliminary objection in our reply whenever we get a case filed against us. And the preliminary objection should contain a newspaper cutting of the fact that doctors have been removed from CPA, the printout of the Rajya Sabha proceedings, printout of the Lok Sabha proceedings, where it has been very clearly said by the minister in the parliament that healthcare is to be removed from the purview of Consumer Protection Act. And with that, we need to put in a preliminary objection that by our understanding, doctors are not covered under CPA. Let the court say otherwise, and then we keep on going in appeal till we reach the Supreme Court, and till let this matter for once and for all again be decided by the Supreme Court. All new cases, as I've said, we need to do this. Thank you so very much. I think I have exceeded my time.
Thank you once again, sir. It was very informative as well as very scary also. Yesterday, I think in your talk, I just heard about this, ki even after the death of a doctor, if some case litigation is going on, the highest also...
This was CPA 2002 amendment, Civil Protection Act 1986, 2002 amendment, which said that during the pendency of a case, opposing the complainant or the opposite party dies, the case does not finish. The case will be carried on against the estate, against the legal heirs of the opposite party, or the complainant can carry on the case. And the payment for compensation, if afforded, will also have to be paid by the estate of the doctor in case he expires.
So in that case, for how long we should keep the records in the hospital?
There is something called Nagpal's rule, which I usually say. That rule says you give an advertisement in two newspapers, or one vernacular, one English. The newspapers should be such which nobody actually reads. Give an advertisement that we are going to destroy our records 30 days from today of records which are more than 5 years old. After 30 days, do not still destroy your records. Keep a copy of that advertisement. If a case is filed against you 18 years later, go to your advocate, go to Gitender, go to Hitesh, show the advertisement and show your medical records. If they find that your medical records are good, they will use the medical records. If they find the medical records are not good, they will use the advertisement. We gave an advertisement before we destroyed the records. So, because otherwise we have multiple laws which say multiple things about how many years to keep the medical records. Till the time CPA is here, discovery rule is here, I will suggest do not destroy your records.
Okay. So, one more thing, you being a medical legal expert, and nowadays we are seeing this medical litigation is such an uprising thing. What do you suggest? How can we, as a doctor, we prevent? Should we treat the patient as we used to do before, first patient and then yourself? Now I think it should be the reverse thing, first yourself and then the patient. Is it true?
First person to be saved is the gynecologist. Second person to be saved is the patient. Third person to be saved is the child.
Look, save yourself first.
Yes.
Any more questions from the audience?
Can I add one thing?
Hitesh, we'll argue later.
No, not argument. Sir, I just want to inform you that a case is filed in Maharashtra against one radiologist for 99 lakh rupees in the district forum. And I have made a special application, miscellaneous application, that this person is not a consumer. So I am arguing it on 10th of December. I have already done it. They were not ready to accept it, but I have done it. So let us see what happens on 10th December.
We keep going in appeal, as I said.
Yes, sir.
Whether we lose, we keep going in appeal.
They will accept him as a consumer. I will take the order and I will go to High Court for as further action. I'm just informing you.
Today also, we have asked one of the major hospitals in Panchkula to add this preliminary objection that they are not covered under the Consumer Protection Act 2019. Let us see how it proceeds.
Sir, I did it already. So we are having at least one case to prove that.
Thank you, sir, for giving us an overview. I had a question. Are the Ayush and these mixopaths also covered under the consumer protection?
Ma'am, effectively, yes. But mother, on paper, yes. But effectively, if you ask me, except for a few cases, one homeopath who was Ashwin Patel versus, I don't know what the name was. This is a very old case.
Poonam Verma.
Ashwin Patel versus Poonam Verma. Then there is a Muftiar Chand judgment. Then there is a few judgments where hospitals have kept Ayush people as residents. I think Hans Charitable Hospital, if I'm not mistaken. These are the kind of few cases where Ayush doctors have been penalized. By law, they are to be penalized, but this thing somehow does not happen. There is no.
Yeah, I think people don't expect them only from them to be giving all the results.
They have a guilt complex. They know when they take modern scientific treatment from Ayush practitioners, they are not supposed to be doing that. So it is similar to what used to happen with dyes. If a gynecologist did a medical termination of pregnancy and caused uterine perforation, she would be crucified. But when a dai used to do and refer, but we used to have regular referrals from some dai sitting somewhere. I don't know how they got so many MTP cases, and my wife, who's a gynecologist, would not. So the point was, we were there only to correct their uterine perforations. And I never found this thing ever. They have been sued for causing a perf. Yes, Dr. Gitin.
Yeah. Sir, two things. First of all, as you have said that they are not sued, it is not so. I have came across multiple cases, not less than 100 cases, filed against Ayurvedic and homeopathic physician. And because they settle the case outside the court in most of the cases, because they have fear that they will definitely lose the case if they will go into the court of law. For giving injection IM, if there is abscess, that kind of 10 cases in case of Ayurvedic physicians we have dealt. So there are so many cases filed against them also, but they are usually settled. And second thing, I will like to add one comment, sir. Although the lecture was fantastic as usual, and there is no comparison of lecturing given by Neeraj Nagpal, sir. But I will like to draw attention to one point, sir, that as you have said that rules are not passed in parliament. It is not so, sir. Rules are also passed through parliament. Okay. So, and rules are also as effective as an act. The basic thing is, rules is how to implement the act, that is the rule. And they are also passed in parliament. So it is not so that they are less effective, but what is less effective, if in rules they have written, in act itself they have written that rules can be amended not by central government or not by parliament but by some lower authority, then the value of rules become less. So giving example, in PCPNDT rules cannot be amended by anybody except the central government or parliament. So that means that rules are as effective as an act. But in some other act, like MTP Act, rules can be amended by state governments. So that means that becomes, rules becomes the state acts in that case. And state can amend the MTP, these rules. So what is the provision of amendment that leads to the effectiveness of the rule? That how much effective it will be?
Dr. Gitender, our argument will carry on for the entire session. I have to go and join another session, give a talk there also. So I'll apologize to Dr. Sangeeta, because Gitender knows how to provoke me, and then we will get into an argument on the session here. So I think it's best avoided. But yes, discuss it, sir.
Thank you for a real lecture, which we all need a reality check. And thank you for making all of us depressed. हम में से बहुत सारे लोग सोच रहे होंगे कि practice continue करेंगे कोई second business शुरू करते seriously.
Seriously, you know, when you go into the depth of all these laws and against doctor, फिर सब यही लगता है कि क्यों doctor practice कर रहा है.
I think IMA and Dr. Neeraj sir is having his medical legal action group. We should file some PIL and should try to make the rules more practical. I'm among those who would not want doctors to be scot free, and there are incidences when the patient by mistake may suffer. So, but the rules have to be practical. The punishment has to be, if they are giving something, it has to be practical. This is not punishment. This is some kind of torture. as if we have some committed some crime by becoming a doctor. The kind of rules which sir was describing and the kind of compensation which we are describing, itna to hum puri zindagi nahi kama payenge jitna ek case mein nikal jayega.
Aisa mental torture with it.
I will tell you one thing, madam. As Dr. Mona madam has said that, you know, this woman wing was there since beginning of IMA, but nobody was active in that. And that's why nobody came to know that WDW was already there with IMA. So in the similar way, the legal wing is already there in IMA.
It is.
In all the IMAs and all the local branches of medical associations, they have legal wings. But they are not active like MLAG. They should be made active like MLAG.
One thing I want to say, sir, like there are so much of reinforcement in Consumer Forum Act. In most of these district court decisions hote hain, they are so weird. So, I mean, as a medical person, you know ki the decisions are all one-sided or it is towards favoring the consumer. So what can be done? And now they have, for the appeal, they have raised so much of the fees. So what, we don't have anything against.
No, ma'am, you have power within you to do something about this. All OPSI members, one of the main problems, I am fighting 3 cases on behalf of doctors in Supreme Court. I'm fighting 4 or 5 cases in high courts. Where is the money? We all want something to be done. When a contribution is asked for, I get 100 messages or emails suggesting how to raise money and only 3 checks. If we are so concerned about it, we need to show that we are concerned. And showing that concern is not only by speaking out, but we need to loosen our belts also. If either you go to court, either you take the matter up, find it out, or help those organizations which are willing to do it.
Here I would say that me and Dr. Sangeeta Srivastava was our IMA president, and we were planning to have a regular yearly legal fees from every doctor. If you don't want this environment to become more suffocating and mentally traumatizing for us, we need to pay. But there is no other option to survive this. So I think
no question. Ultimately, we keep on saying that this is what is happening is wrong. When somebody asks me if it is wrong, what have you done about it? You know, I can say with pride that I have made an effort on my behalf. How many of us can do that?
Very good. You were absolutely
right.
Thank
you, sir. It was very, very much encouraging. Very nice lecture by you, as you always give. We all have benefited by it. And as you say, you have to go for some other lecture also. So, but we like to have you more often in our jogs or in with IMA, because it's really eye opening for most of the doctors. See, and we must be aware of all these laws and changes which keep on coming every year. Unless and until we are updating ourselves, it is very difficult to save ourselves. So thank you so much, sir, for your very much informative lecture.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, chairpersons. Here, Geeta Guin madam has joined. She was the one who has helped us a lot in conducting this CME. Although she was busy with webinar from past 2 days, so she could not actively participate. But madam, we have to acknowledge all the effort and all the promotion which you do. And she is our legal expert, like local illegal expert. And she is a very iron-fisted lady also. She is very disciplinarian, isn't it?
Yes.
Madam is professor, Department of Obs and Gynae at NSCB Medical College. Madam has area, she's a LLB, she's a qualified advocate amongst us. And her area of interest is medico-legal critical care in OBS and high-risk pregnancy. Madam is East Zone Coordinator, FOCSI, Ethics and Medico-Legal Committee, Joint Secretary, MP Medical Teachers Association, and has done lots of work there. She really knows how to look into the eye of storm, isn't it? And Madam is President-elect Jabalpur OBS and Gynae. Madam, I would like you to say a few words.
Oh, I don't know, Neetu, I really never needed all those introduction. You made me feel like a Dracula in front of everyone. But it was my really very proud privilege to have Dr. Neeraj Nagpal and my very dear friends, Hitesh and Gitendra, and of course, Dr. Tiwari. And somehow I feel that the medico-legal scenario vis-a-vis awareness in Jabalpur is very, very infantile. You know, people are hardly bothered looking at the files and everything, and the way they are acting. People are going and operating on Central Pleasant Apriviya, and you ask them, "Do you have a medical indemnity?" They said, "Nee, abhi kara lenge." So I feel like they're very daring, you know, and it was really a great effort by you and Sangeeta ma'am to have this webinar. And I really hope that people in Jabalpur will become better. And I want to take forward Dr. Neeraj's message and concern that the minute we ask for some contribution, we all start to shudder. Now let us start thinking that we have to put in at least $5,000 each member and collect that money and give it to somebody who is willing to take the fight forward. If I cannot fight, I can at least provide the ration for the fight. So with that, Neetu, I think you should carry on with the webinar further.
Thank you, ma'am.
And Neetu, I have been in the webinar throughout. You just made me feel so bad.
Oh, I apologize. I missed that.
Ma'am, I agree with you that everybody should contribute so that we have a smooth sailing. And I would request all our national speakers to say this to our yes. People in our city that we need to collect money so that our sailing goes on smoothly. And Neeraj sir, we really enjoyed your lecture, but it was really very frightening. And I would just say one word, ki we have so many intelligent people in this medico-legal we just request people like us request you people to find a way out of all these things. It's so frightening for us to hear all these things. The lecture was so much into detail of everything, what can be done to us. So I'm really frightened.
So let us just collect the money and hand it over to these guys, and I'm sure we'll be out.
They'll do a good job. I have been following. It's like first webinar or conference where I have seen sir speaking, but I have seen his write up, and they are logical and they are real. So I think, and the thing which he said that we need money for this, we as doctor have to. This is a simple formula which has been followed through centuries. People have invested money in governments and in laws to push them so as to reap benefit. So if you want to survive and reap benefit, you have to invest. If we can pass this notion to people who are attending and communicate with others, I think the purpose of medico-legal workshop would be done. And the second thing, if we stop behaving like ostrich, na sir niche daba diya aur socha ki hamare sath nahi hoga, wo kisi ke sath hua hoga jisne galti kari hogi. No, it's not like that. There are people who are suffering despite of doing the best. So this can happen to anyone. So I think sir would be wanting to leave. Sir, thank you. We would like to have you again and again to open hamari antaratma ke chakshu kholne ke liye aap aaye.
Anytime, ma'am.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
On behalf of IMA WDW, we all thank you once again.
Okay. So we'll move on to our next lecture. And I'll invite our chairperson, Dr. Neeta Pol Manish.
Dr. Tiwari has just joined. Please welcome him. Dr. Mukul Tiwari has just joined, and please welcome him.
Also, welcome again.
Thank you, madam. I was there before also, but our Ivlia conference is going on, so I had to leave temporarily.
Again, sir is again a very active.
Very well.
We are pediatrician, and I am happy so many pediatricians are there, and so many pediatricians are active doing all this. Sir is a very eminent personality in pediatrics. He is doing great work in medico-legal work, and he's a very good writer. He has published many books. So, welcome, sir. And less I think than you. Pardon, sir?
Less than you.
Oh my God. I'm just taking baby step. I may not appear like a baby, but I'm taking baby step.
I met you in Nagpur last time.
Yes, sir.
That was the last time, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank
sir.
You so much.
Come on, let us go for the next lecture.
So, the second lecture, I would like to invite our chairperson, Dr. Neeta Pohl, madam, who is a senior pediatrician. She has been IP secretary for almost 5 years, and too many academic activities were done in her tenure. And Dr. Chitra Jain, madam, our president-elect for WDW. Madam has done so much work in social and obs and gynae that I think that I would not be able to enumerate all of them. I welcome both of them, and I request Dr. Neeta Pohl, madam, to introduce our speaker.
Hello, everyone. The speakers and delegates. For some reason, I'm sorry, my video is not starting. So I'll be just unmuting and talking. My job is to introduce speaker, Dr. Hitesh Bhatt. Dr. Hitesh Bhatt has done his MBBS and MD in Obs and Gynae, and he has also done LLB. He is practicing in medico-legal field for last more than 20 years. Currently, he is practicing in Andheri, Mumbai. He is a medico-legal consultant for Wadia Maternity Hospital, Central Railway Hospital, Mumbai, and more than 80 hospitals across India. He is partner in medico-legal firm, and he has authored like Consent in Obs and Gynae, and also a book named Law, What Doctors Know. He has lived in many national and state level conferences, and he has served as office bearer for IMA and AME. So we'll talk about herbal medicine.
I think there is something wrong with the...
I just Hitesh, 1 minute. He's my best buddy, and I just want to say he's one of those daring guys who gave up his registration with the Medical Council of India and registered himself with the Bar Council of Mumbai and the Supreme Court of India, and that really needs a big jigger. And he's doing so excellently, and it's always a pleasure meeting up with him. Unfortunately, because of Corona, we cannot meet up in person. But Hitesh, it's so nice to have you and to listen to you. Welcome to Jabalpur, and hope you'll be in person to Jabalpur very soon. Come, Hitesh. Yeah.
So thank you, madam, for a nice introduction. And I'm straight going to the subject. And the topic given to me is about the telemedicine. So... as the Rudyard Kipling has said, that the God can't be everywhere, and therefore he made mothers. Similarly, I say that doctors could not be everywhere, and therefore they made telemedicine. So that is, in short, what telemedicine is all about. All this problem started with the case of Deepa Pavaskar versus state of Maharashtra. This couple, the Dr. Deepa and her husband, they were doctors and they were running a practice in Maharashtra. They did cesarean. Then after third day of section, they went for AICOG conference. They were in the conference. Patient had some problem. Then they, on a telephone, they gave instruction to the staff. They admitted the patient in the hospital. The sister used to give medicine. Then patient condition worsened and then ultimately referred to some other doctor. And then patient died. And the Mumbai High Court, they took very serious note of this, that you cannot prescribe any medicine without a proper diagnosis. And that is where the telemedicine practice was questioned. And there were so many speculations and so many doubts. And the newspaper cuttings have started showing that no telephonic consultations and all. So even Karnataka Medical Council also circulated a notice, no for telemedicine practice. So IMA took a step and they asked Medical Council of India
about the guidelines on telemedicine, whether it should be done or not, and if it should be done, then what are the guidelines? At that time, the Medical Council of India was also on the verge of dying. It was being replaced by the National Medical Commission. And during the in-between period, it was governed by the governors. So the governors, those who were running the show, the board of governors, they came out with Niti Aayog about the telemedicine practice guidelines. And then it was notified into the gazette on the 12th May 2020, and then it became a law. Now, what are these guidelines? That is what we have to understand. Now, these guidelines are now a part of Indian Medical Council regulations, that is Code of Conduct, Professional Conduct, Etiquette and Ethics 2002. It has become the part of it. It is now added as a section 3.8.1. And it says that consultation through telemedicine by registered medical practitioner under Indian Medical Council Act shall be permissible in accordance with the guidelines as given in Appendix 5. That means it will continue. Previously, people had doubt that whether it is only for a COVID period or what, but it is a permanent thing. This is added as an amendment into the Indian Medical Council Act. So that is first thing we have to understand. Now, what are the definitions given into it? We will see the definitions. I will give you the important points only. Telemedicine is defined as a delivery of the healthcare services where distance is a critical factor by all healthcare professionals. So by using the information and communication technologies. There is another word, telehealth. And telehealth is, it is a part, telemedicine is a part of telehealth. Telehealth includes other things also, like health information, patient education, digital communication technologies. So whatever we are doing today with the Zoom platform, the discussing about the medicine or telemedicine or the medical legal part is a part of telehealth, but it is not telemedicine. So if you see this whole gamut of telehealth, that includes telemedicine. Telehealth is a bigger spectrum, while telemedicine is a part of telehealth. So telemedicine includes all channel of communication with the patient, including video, audio, text, and digital data exchange. The guideline specifically excludes the specification for the hardware and software. So Medical Council of India do not give a particular importance to any particular app. If somebody comes and tells you that this is IMA app, Medical Council of India approved app, then it is wrong. They have said any platform you use, it can be even the active or passive communication. What is active communication? Whatever we are doing today is active communication. Patient is sending you a video or patient is in video chat with you, it is active communication. But patient is sending you email or message and then you are replying the message or email at your leisure time, it is passive communication. So active or passive communication, both are included in telemedicine. It does not provide for consultation outside the jurisdiction of the India. Now, emergency consultation, what the telemedicine guideline says? It says telemedicine services should, however, be avoided for emergency care when alternative in-person care is available. And telemedicine consultation should be limited to first aid, life-saving measure, consultation, and advice on referral. So if somebody tells you, doctor, I'm having chest pain, what should I do? Don't start giving them the entire medicines. You just give them the primary. You can just put sorbitrate below the tongue and go to a doctor nearby. That is what you have to do in a telemedicine in emergency. Otherwise, in-person care is preferred over telemedicine in emergency. In case of all emergency, the patient must be advised for an in-person interaction with the RMP at the earliest. Now, there are a few more definitions. RMP, registered medical practitioner, we all know it is defined as a person who is enrolled in the state register or the national register under the Indian Medical Council Act. Health worker could be a nurse, allied health personnel, mid-level health practitioner, ANM, or any other health worker designated by an appropriate authority. Caregiver. Caregiver could be a family member or any person authorized by the patient to represent the patient. And there could be two possible sittings as far as the caregiver is concerned. Caregiver is somebody who is coming with the patient, the relative, or anybody who is giving care to the patient. The patient is present with the caregiver during consultation, or patient is not present with the caregiver. And when patient is not present, again, there can be two possibilities. One, patient is minor, and the parent is talking to you. The parent is caregiver in that situation.
And minor here is less than 16 years of age and not 18 as in other laws. And caregiver has a formal authorization or a verified document establishing the relationship with the patient. If patient tells you during in-person consultation or otherwise that this person is my caregiver and he shall consult you for future, then that person becomes the caregiver. So patient caregiver can be introduced by the patient as well. In all above, that means in caregiver case, the consult should proceed as in case of RNP with the patient. You have to consider caregiver as a patient and you have to consult them. That is what the guideline says. Now, telemedicine can be between patient to RMP. It can be between caregiver to RMP. It can be between RMP to RMP. And it can be between health worker to RMP. So these are the four ways the telemedicine or teleconsultation can happen. Now, identification of the registered medical practitioner and the patient is required. This is very much important. Telemedicine consultation should not be anonymous. It is not a Facebook chat or WhatsApp chat where the person can remain anonymous. You must have seen there are many anonymous accounts, fake accounts. They chat you, and mostly that happens with the boys. Some girl, they chat with the boy, and when they meet, actually the other person is also a male. But that is not possible in telemedicine. What is required is an RMP should verify and confirm patient's identity by name, age, address, email address, phone and phone number, registered ID, by all means. And for issuing the prescription, the RMP need to explicitly ask for the age of the patient. If there is any doubt, seek for the age proof. And that is true even for in-person consultation as well. If there is a doubt about the age, you have to confirm the age. And the patient is minor, then after confirming the age, the teleconsultation would be allowed only if the minor is consulting along with an adult. So this is what the doctor has to do. An RMP should begin the consultation by informing the patient about his or her name and qualification. So doctor is also duty bound to tell the patient that he is a consultant or a super consultant or what his practice is, his registration number, everything. And he should display all these things in the registration number, in his prescription, on all the consultation, his website, everything. It can't be anonymous. Consent is required of the patient in two situations. Consent can be implied or explicit. What is implied consent? Implied consent is when both the parties know what is going to happen. And explicit consent means it is a written consent or it is told consent to the other party. If patient initiates telemedicine consultation, the consent is implied. You need not take any consent because patient knows that she is consulting you or contacting you over a telemedicine platform. But the explicit consent is required when a health worker, RMP or caregiver initiates the telemedicine consultation. So if some other than the patient starts the consultation, then the consult, there has to be a consent. And what is the format of consent? Only one word by the patient. Yes, I consent to avail consultation via telemedicine. If she sends this message, writes this message, or records this message, then it is a consent from the patient side. And that RMP must record this consent in patient's record. Now, we have to understand two more things. First consultation and follow-up. What is first consultation? When the patient consults first to the RMP for any disease or the patient has consulted the RMP earlier, but more than 6 months have passed. So every 6 months, it will be considered as first consultation. Or the patient has consulted the RMP, but for a different health condition. Now the disease have changed. Then it is first consultation. Follow-up consultation means consulting within 6 months, or the patient has new symptoms, or the RMP does not recall the previous record or previous treatment. In all this case, it will be follow-up consultation. Why I am telling you all this definition is because at the end, you will understand from one chart that what is the importance of all these things. Telemedicine has its own set of limitations. If a physical examination is critical, RMP should not proceed until the physical examination is arranged. So RMP can hold the exam, the further consultation, and they can ask patient to come in person for consultation or refer to some RMP, and who will ultimately send the findings of the patient to this RMP, and the consultation can happen. RMP shall maintain all the patient record, including case history, investigation reports, images, etc., as appropriate. Now we are coming to the last section, that is the drug list. And what is the importance of drug list? That we will see in my next last slide. The drug list is actually the list of drugs as O, A, and B. Now, this is not the actually the schedules of the drug under Drug Act. What is list O? That is over-the-counter drugs. Over-the-counter drugs are the drugs which can be given by to anybody by the pharmacist at the drug pharmacy without any prescription. So these are the drugs that includes antipyretics or cough supplements or ORS packets or some zinc syrup or vitamin C or some vitamin supplements. All these are over-the-counter drugs and that can be given without prescription. That is listed as list O. Remember this. This is very important. List A drugs are the drugs for the treatment, the actual drug for the treatment, which you give for the treatment. That includes the ointments, includes the medicines, ear drops, everything, like all the drugs which can be given for drugs for hypertension, asthma, diabetes, any drug which you give for, to the patient over a, after the diagnosis. And list B is the same drug, but you are giving it as an add-on drug. So if patient has consulted you before and you want to add some drug, suppose you have given one drug for hypertension today, you have started with Depin. Patient's blood pressure is not maintained after that medicine. You want to add some diuretic or atenolol, then that atenolol becomes list B drug. And vice versa. If you started with atenolol, that will fall in list A, but you want to add now with the some diazepam or some other diuretics or any other drug for hypertension, then that becomes list B drug. So it is interchangeable. It depends how you are using that drug. It is not the schedule of the drug. It is basically based on the use of the drug. So list O, list A, list B. This is the list. And there is one more list is called prohibited list of drugs. And prohibited list of drugs are the drugs which are narcotic drugs, psychotropic drugs, and Schedule X drugs as per the Drug and Cosmetic Act. These drugs can't be prescribed over the telemedicine. So what is the importance of all this? So we have learned about emergency and non-emergency consultation. We have learned about the IT medium that can be audio, video, or text. We have learned about the first consultation and follow-up consultation. And we have learned about the group of drugs, O group, A group, B group, and prohibited. Now we summarize all this in this table. And this is the most important table you have to remember for telemedicine practice. Group O drug, that can be given on first consultation or on follow-up consultation. And the type of consultation can be video, audio, or text. You can give group O drug by any means in any type of consultation. List A drugs. List A drugs can be given in first consultation or in follow-up consultation, but only on a video consultation. There has to be video consultation, otherwise you can't give list A drugs. List B drugs can be given as a follow-up drugs in a follow-up consultation, either by audio, video, or text. And the prohibited list drug that cannot be prescribed by any method of telemedicine. So this was the importance of all this definition. And that is why I taught you the definition first. The prescription, if you want, that has to be provided in a photo or a scan format. Do not send prescription in a Word format, which patient can change. You have to have a prescription in this format. You then the prescription must have, or you can use some app, and it must have your registration number, your name as a imprint or as a stamp. And it can be sent via email or messaging. And if you are transmitting prescription directly to the pharmacy to give medicine to the patient, then the consent of the patient is required. Otherwise, you cannot give prescription directly to the pharmacy. This is the format of the prescription, which can be used. And the professional fees. Professional fees can be charged. And what I suggest you here is always charge first. Ask patient to pay first and then you consult. Because after you consult and then you charge, patient may cut the phone. You may not be knowing the patient. Patient may be from anywhere in India. And it is very difficult to recover your charges. So learn something from your the mistakes of some other doctors who have done. Please take your charges first and you are entitled to the charge. Only thing is you have to declare your charge before starting the consultation. So in summary, an RMP should exercise their professional judgment to decide whether a telemedicine consultation is appropriate in a given situation or not. So all consultant, once you start consultation, if you feel that you have to see the patient, then you have to see the patient. And we have see, we have learned in our studies that there are four things: inspection, palpation, percussion, and auscultation. Over a telemedicine, you can do only two things: inspection, and you can take the history. Palpation, percussion, and auscultation cannot be done. So whatever diagnosis you can make by the history and inspection, you can go ahead and give the treatment. But where the palpation, percussion, and auscultation is required, please call the patient or send to some other RMP and then make a diagnosis and then treat the patient. Identification of the RMP and patient is must. Mode of communication can be audio, video, and text. Consent is must if the consultation is started from your side or healthcare person or by the caregiver. Type of consultation can be first and follow-up. Patient evaluation, diagnosis is must, and prescription you have to give in the format which I have said. As far as negligence is concerned, negligence is, it is patient shall be responsible for accuracy of the information given to you. RMP asking for another RMP's advice remain the treating RMP and shall be responsible for the treatment. You can't say, I have called Gitendra and he suggested this treatment and that is why I have given this to the patient. The primary RMP will be the RMP who is treating the patient, even though he has consulted some senior. And if the RMP feels that information provided is inadequate, he has to hold the consultation and send the patient for in person. So then the negligence will remain same as defined here, to do something which a prudent man in similar situation will not do, or to do not to do something which a prudent man in similar situation will do. The definition will remain same. The parameters for negligence will remain same. Documentation is must. You have to document everything. If there is any breach in documentation because of the platform, then RMP is not liable. That is also mentioned. Suppose you are talking on a Zoom and suddenly it drops. You cannot record something. You cannot do something. Or it is a problem because of this platform, then you are not liable for the same. Otherwise, the penalties are same as per the IMC Act, the ethics and other prevailing laws. So friends, you cannot be the, I heard somebody telling that we want to leave the medical practice. So I am always telling that to be 100% safe from medical legal problems, you can start either your band, you can become photographer, you can join Bollywood, you can join some saint, or you can join Daud gang. Ultimately, what you have to do, you have to run away and leave medical practice. Then only you can be 100% safe from medical legal problems. But that is not possible. So I always tell that it is very easy to diagnose your own piles. If you follow Baba Ramdev, you can do this. But it is impossible to be out of medical legal problem while being in a medical practice. So just know the law. Remain strict to the guidelines. Do not panic. Do not keep concentrating on a problem which has happened. You may harm the other normal case. And always have stress-free practice. And I always tell that to have stress-free practice, you must practice to remain stress-free. This is very important. Stay safe. Stay healthy. Thank you very much for patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nitesh.
Any questions? I think you said right that if you are practicing, you are bound to fall sometime maybe into such medical legal issues. And this is a reality which we should take. And definitely the best thing is to be prepared for it.
Right.
And do your practice in a way where you can foresee that if I take this action, this may lead to this.
My teacher used to tell that if you do not perforate, that means you are not doing enough MPPs. Similarly, I am telling you, if you are not getting a single notice during your entire life, that means you are not having enough patients. Please increase your practice.
So you have given like a silver lining in a dark cloud. We all were like a bit depressed.
Don't get depressed, madam. The problems are always there. Only two people are problemless. The one who is not born and the one who has died.
The one who's dead.
Otherwise, everybody is having problems. So take it lightly. It is a part and parcel of the practice. It is a like every profession has a professional hazard. This is a professional hazard and we have to take it. We have to move forward.
Yeah, we just have to take it head on. And since you are a practicing lawyer, there was this WhatsApp message where a Delhi hospital was sued and 10 lakhs of compensation were rewarded just because the consent was printed and they found it to be inappropriate. So,
what I have seen, madam, that judgment itself is challenged. And the thing is, that was not the correct word which should be used in the judgment for the fault which was there. There was a fault, because Supreme Court has very clearly said that consent should be procedure specific. It should have the proper format. You have to say certain things. So consent has to be procedure specific. You can't have a blanket consent. That is what the court wanted to say. Still, it was challenged because the words used were not proper. The printed consent will not be allowed. That is wrong thing. That should not have been there. And this problem comes because there are very few lawyers who are actually into medico-legal practice. Or there are few doctors who have actually become lawyer, or they are actually they are into medico-legal practice, who can guide you properly. If the representation is not proper, then the case will have this type of judgment. So it is always better to have somebody who knows the law or medico-legal law. See, there are more than 10,000 laws. Every lawyer is not expected to know each and every law. If somebody asks me about family laws or say the Land Requisition Act, I don't know that. I cannot deal with this type of cases. But they don't refuse to take the case. That is the problem. And we go, like, we have a heart problem, we go to a chest physician or a cardiologist. We don't go to a gynecologist for heart problem. Otherwise, in eyes of the layman, they both are doctors. Similarly, in eyes of us, all are advocates, but advocates also have a specialized field.
Specialized.
You have to choose a person who is actually dealing with the medico-legal problems.
So this so means... This
one thing I want to ask Neetu ma'am. Ritesh sir, if the consent is procedure specific, but it is typed once, so there is no problem, right?
No, there is no problem. You can go ahead and do it. But only thing is the blanks you have to fill, because even if we type, we leave the printed consent, there are blanks. You have to fill the patient's name, indication, the signature, witness's signature, because the courts have said that when doctors do not have time to fill in the gaps, we have no reason to believe that this was explained to the patient. So it can't be left blank. And our practice is, we just leave blank. We just take signature. We don't write the things that we have to write. The alternates we have to write, the probable risk we have to write, whatever blanks are there that we have to fill in.
I would like to know about number of witnesses which are like compulsory to get a consent.
Minimum two. In every contract, if you see, minimum two. In even government consents, which they have come out with, they also have given two witnesses. So the normal dictum is you have to have two witnesses for any document.
And they have to be beside the, like, I'm a pediatrician. If I get signed it from father, the other two witnesses can be from the family member or hospital or someone else.
Witness means, what is the role of witness? Witness need not know what is written about. The role of witness is to say that I have seen this person signing in front of me.
Okay.
And any person more than 18 years of age with sane mind can sign as a witness.
Okay. So can we use our hospital staff for doing that?
100%. Yes, 100%. But the party cannot become witness of his own self. Like, doctor cannot sign as a witness.
Yeah, so doctor cannot.
Doctor signature is there, patient signature is there, and two independent witness. That means apart from these two people, everybody is independent. They can sign if they are more than 18 years of age with sane mind.
Okay, because finding witness is a tough job otherwise.
No, you can have, at least you should have two staff.
Two staff to sign. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Okay. My question is,
one more thing. You can use the consent on our website, consentfordoctor.com. We have made a specific website there. It will not print until and unless you fill all the gaps. So we have made that provision, and the consent will be printed, and it is procedure specific consent for all 13 branch of medicine. Pediatric consent, ICU consent, obstetric gynec consent, all consents are there. Psychiatric consent, medicine consent, oncology consents, plastic surgery consent, dermatology consent, all consents are there. ENT consent, orthopedic consent, everything is there online.
That's great. I was just aware that Foxy is having all those printed consent.
No, Foxy is making it for OBGYN, but we are already having it. And it is online version. And you can, and we are constantly changing it. If something new will come, we will change it. So ultimately, what printout you will get will be the updated version of that.
Updated version of that.
Yes. So we are constantly updating it.
Thank you, sir.
Sir,
the list of drugs like drug A list and B list? Do we have that list of those drugs?
Madam, that is what I said. It is not the schedule. It is the drug which you can, suppose you see that this is tinea and you want to prescribe antifungal drug, that becomes list A drug. If you want to add something to it, then it becomes list B drug. So if you are giving, say, ketoconazole, and now you are giving something else, now say you want to add, then that becomes group B drug or list B drug. Or if you start with something else and then you add ketoconazole, then ketoconazole becomes list B drug. So list A and list B is first consultation and second consultation or add-on drug.
Only the D drug cannot be prescribed.
O is over-the-counter, and prohibited drug cannot be prescribed. That is according to the schedule. That is schedule X drug and narcotic drugs. This cannot be prescribed in any condition.
Thank you, Dr. Hitesh. It was really an enlightening lecture by you. And nowadays, everybody is practicing. So we need to know all this in detail. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Chairperson, and thank you, eminent speaker. It was nice, and telemedicine is something which is new to us. Patients are just jumping, and most of the time they expect that we'll give it free. That is our own other practical problem which we have to deal. But medico-legal issues related to telemedicine are something which we need to learn. Now we'll just, because we are like short on time, I'll quickly move to our next third lecture. And our chairperson for this lecture are Dr. Priyanka Kukrele, madam. She is associate professor at NSCB Medical College, and her specialization is MD. She is the one who's looking after the corona ward for past so many months with her team. She has done fellowship in diabetes and endocrinology and has many international papers and is a national faculty. Welcome, madam. And the second chairperson, I am forgetting. Dr.
Kavita Sachdeva, madam.
Dr. Kavita Sachdeva, yeah. Madam. Sorry. So I think that I'm becoming old here. Yes, Dr. Kavita Sachdeva, again, madam, is the HOD of ENT department in NSCB Medical College. She has started many new surgeries and has done training for many advanced surgeries in ENT department. And again, she is a national faculty and won lots of prizes. Welcome, madam. I would request Dr. Priyanka Kukrele, madam, to welcome our speaker.
Thank you, ma'am. I would like to congratulate the organizers for this unique CME on this unique topic, which was very much needed for our fraternity. Now, without wasting time, I take the honor to introduce Dr. Gitendra Sharma. He is practicing gynecologist and obstetrician in Ahmedabad for 28 years. He has done MD in obs and gyne. He is medico-legal counselor. He has also done the LLB degree with 15 gold medals, topped Gujarat University of Law. And he is author of books like Law in Obs and Gyne Practice, Consents in Obs and Gyne, Laws a Doctor Must Know. He has given more than 1,500 lectures all over the world. He is vice president-elect FOCSI 2022. He is chairperson Ethics Medico-Legal Committee FOCSI 2017-19. He is president AOGS 2016-17. He has hosted AI COG in 2017 January. He is an honorary joint secretary of SOGOG in 2017-2019. So I request Dr. Gitendra Sharma sir to kindly go with the lecture, sir.
Good evening, everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank Women Wing of IIMA Jabalpur for inviting me for this lecture. In specific, Dr. Sangeeta Srivastava, who was in continuous touch with me. So many names I can see, Dr. Geeta Guin, Dr. Sonal Shukla Madam, and all known to me very closely. So thank you for inviting me. Hope we are not short of time today. If at any moment, if you feel that I am lengthening the lecture, then please tell me 5 minutes in advance so that I can conclude my lecture within time. We all know medical litigations are increasing day by day. I am not going to use my PPT because I want to give the messages which our ear should hear directly, and I do not want your eyes to be tired of now. So medical litigations against doctors are increasing. We all know in Consumer Act, the amount of compensation is also increasing day by day. In 1995, it was, I think, 19 lakhs rupees in one of the cases of V. Chandrasekhar, who was a tennis player, against Apollo Hospital, Chennai. And then in 2009, it rose to 1 crore rupees in Prashant Dhananka's case against Nizam Institute of Medical Science in Hyderabad. And in 2013, that amount rose to 5.76 crore rupees in case of this Balram Saha versus Amri Hospital, Calcutta, against Amri Hospital. And with interest, it rose to 11.76 crore rupees. Criminal litigations are also increasing day by day. And there is 104% rise in criminal litigation against doctor. And that is the more important thing, that why so many litigations against doctor, particularly in criminal law. And whenever I start my lecture, I used to tell all my colleagues, friends, that ignorance of law is no excuse. So that's why you must know the law. And to know the law, you must attend such medical legal conferences. And second, prevention is always better than cure. Once something happens, ek bar aap jail mein chale gaye, to aapko bail leni padegi, chhutna padega, bahut koshish karni padegi. But you have to suffer. So prevention is always better than cure. And that's why preventive medico-legal aspect is a new branch which is coming up. And we are doing that kind of work in medical science. Sorry to say, but in 40% litigation in criminal law, doctor is behind doctor. So if some doctor gives opinion against the colleague, only then FIR can be filed against the colleague. So that means in 40%, 50% litigation, doctor is behind doctor. And that requires some deep thinking. If we stop criticizing our colleague, if we stop giving opinion against our colleague, this problem can be over. As said by Dr. Neeraj Nagpal, there are multiple fora where patient can file complaint. In civil court, in consumer court, in commissions, Human Rights Commission, Women Rights Commission, or other commissions, in council, State Medical Council, Medical Council of India, and Chief Minister's Office, CMO's Office, then so many, Prime Minister's Office, and last but not least, FIR can be lodged in under criminal law at police station. And if police station does not accept that FIR, then the patient can go to court to file FIR. So these are different fora where a complaint can be filed. Now, today's topic given to me is criminal liability in medical practice. Now, we must know the word criminal and liability. We must understand this. Criminal means what? Criminal means it is related to crime. So what is the meaning of crime? If we go to the definition of crime, it is C-R-I-M-E. C means conduct. Some action from your side must be there. I means intention. Intention must be, that conduct should be done with intention. Now tell me, who is the doctor who will kill patient intentionally? So, and result of conduct done with intention. So, crime is a result of conduct done with intention. And after doing that particular action, there must be guilt of mind, that is mens rea should be there. And some enlisted punishment should be there under certain law. Then only it becomes crime. Now, what is liability? We all know liability is for negligence. And rightly said by Dr. Hitesh, the last slide was very nicely narrated, that to do something what a normal prudent doctor will not do, and not to do something what a normal prudent doctor will do, would do in that particular circumstances, that is a negligence. So omission or commission, both can be negligence. And it is very simple to understand negligence. So act of commission and act of omission, both can be negligence. Now to understand negligence, we must understand under whenever patient enters in the hospital of doctor, there is an implied contract between doctor and patient. What is that contract? Contract is to give, it is a duty of doctor to care the patient. And that care should be of certain standard. Now, if doctor breaches his duty, and if due to breach of duty, if there is some damage to the patient, that damage is compensated under law, under consumer law. So that is a civil law. But if that negligence is gross, means it is unpardonable beyond doubt, then it is a gross, then only a criminal negligence, criminal liability comes into picture. Now, to understand criminal liability, we must know what is the difference between civil liability and criminal liability, because in we all know that a case is also filed by a patient in consumer court, as well as FIR is filed in police. Both actions are simultaneous usually in most of the cases. So what is the basic difference between consumer liability or civil liability and criminal liability? Because the basic jurisprudential concept of negligence is absolutely different in civil law and criminal law. See, in civil law, it is clear that it is pro-consumer. Means, whenever there is smallest amount of deficiency or damage to the patient, that must be compensated. That is the principle in consumer law. While in criminal law, the principle is absolutely opposite. It is said that person is innocent till he is proved guilty beyond doubt. That means even 100 criminals can be left out, but no innocent should be punished. That is the principle of criminal law. So that is known as strict interpretation. Under criminal law, there is a strict interpretation. Everything is to be proved beyond doubt. While in consumer law, only a possibility is enough that due to this, this damage has happened. If it is not proved beyond doubt, even then compensation can be granted. So simple lack of care is enough to attract consumer liability, while to attract criminal liability, the negligence should be a gross negligence. In civil law, it is sufficient to prove the neglect of duty, simple neglect. But to attract criminal liability, the prosecution has to prove beyond doubt that whatever has happened is the direct and proximate cause of the action done by the doctor. Intention may or may not be there in civil liability, but in criminal liability, intention must be there. Intention must be proved. Mens rea should be there. In civil law, compensation is the punishment. While in criminal law, we all know there is imprisonment, and compensation or fine may or may not be there. Basically, in civil law, personal patient's damage is there. So case is filed against a particular person. So case will be doctor against so-and-so patient. But in criminal law, the right in rem is violated. Whole society's right is violated due to the criminal act. And that's why case is filed against so-and-so doctor against state of Gujarat or MP or Maharashtra like that. So basically, to understand that criminal, to attract criminal liability, the negligence should be a gross negligence. That we must understand. Now, second thing, the police has no role in civil cases. Why? In criminal cases, FIR is filed at police station and police can take action. Now, to understand criminal liability, there are a few sections under which usually the cases are filed against doctor. We all know 302, 304, 304A, 336, 37, 38, 312 to 18, they are MTP related, 269 to 272 sections, these are biomedical waste related. So these are all sections under which usually the cases are filed. Now, to understand criminal liability, every doctor must know what is the difference between 302, 304 and 304A. Because in many of the cases, usually police officers file case under 304 and they try to arrest the doctor. So whether that 304 can be applied or not. So basically, for a crime, there are three things which are important. One is conduct, second is intention, third is knowledge. When you do something with intention and with knowledge that your act is going to kill the patient, then it is murder, 302. It is punished under 302. But if one of the ingredient of intention and knowledge is not there, then it is 304. So there are two sections in 304. 304.1 says that conduct done with intention without knowledge. Means you have killed intentionally the patient, although you don't have knowledge that your act will kill the patient, but you have done intentionally. And that particular section is never applied against doctor, because doctor can never kill patient intentionally. So 304 subsection 2, it says that act done without intention with knowledge. So here knowledge is there. Intention may not be there. What is that? So I always give one example. Suppose you are a gynecologist. You are staying 5 minutes away from your clinic. Now your clinic received one patient of central placenta previa with severe bout. And you get a call from the hospital. Madam, we have received one patient with severe bout. Please come urgently. Otherwise patient will die. And you are 5 minutes away. But you don't reach hospital even for half an hour. After half an hour, you reach the hospital and patient dies. That means you have knowledge that if you will not reach within 5 minutes into the hospital, patient may die. Even then you have not reached the hospital within 5 minutes and you reached after half an hour. So that is the basic difference between knowledge. So in such cases, usually 304 is applied, subsection 2 is applied by the police people. 304A is a death due to rash and negligent act. Intention may not be there, knowledge may not be there. So here only conduct is there, no intention, no knowledge. But ultimately patient dies due to the conduct. So only conduct is there. So usually in medical practice, 304A is applied and no other sections are applied. That we must understand. Now to understand criminal liability, we must know four cases. First is Jacob Matthews versus State of Punjab. Second is Suresh Gupta versus Delhi NCT Delhi. Third case is M. D'Souza versus Mohammed Ishfaq. Fourth case is Mahendra Kaushik versus State of UP. And last but not least is the Bolam's test. If you know these five things, then you can understand what is criminal liability. Since Suresh Gupta's case, he was a plastic surgeon practicing in Delhi. He was dealing with one case of nasal septal deviation. On table, patient died. Patient had nothing pre-op. There was no abnormality pre-op. But on table, patient died. Post-mortem was done. On post-mortem, it was found that patient had died of aspiration. And aspiration was because the cuffed endotracheal tube, which was put for giving anesthesia, was not of proper size. So by the side of the tube, that blood got aspirated in the lungs and patient died. That was the post-mortem report. Now, challenging this, doctor went into, in high court, he lost the case, but in Supreme Court, he went into appeal for quashing the case, quashing the FIR. Now, he got success in that. And Supreme Court in this particular case has particularly used the word gross. So gross word was very first time put in a case of Suresh Gupta versus Delhi NCT. And it was said by the Supreme Court that every negligence cannot attract criminal liability. But if the negligence is gross, then only criminal case can be filed against doctor. Now, what is the meaning of gross? That is defined in IMA versus VP Shanta, Jacob Matthews, and all other cases, M. D'Souza versus Mohammed Ishfaq. They said that gross means something which is absolutely unusual. No prudent doctor will ever do that in the practice if that kind of negligence is there. So suppose if you operate on wrong limb, suppose you operate on wrong eye, instead of right eye, you operate left eye. Suppose you leave mop or instrument in the abdomen. Suppose some homeopathic doctor who have no knowledge of surgery operates on a patient and patient dies. So these are all the examples. If you give wrong gases in place of oxygen, you give nitrous oxide and patient dies. These are all the examples of gross negligence. So to understand, in short, basically in books, if some complication is mentioned, then it is not a gross negligence. But if in books something is not mentioned even as a complication, if that kind of thing is done by the doctor, then it is known as gross negligence. In second case of Jacob Matthews versus State of Punjab, after the judgment, we got judgment, Suresh Gupta judgment was in 2004. And in 2005, we got the judgment of Jacob Matthews versus State of Punjab. That was a very nice judgment given by three judges, Justice Bala Subramaniam, Justice Mathur, and Justice Lahoti. All three later on become the Chief Justice of India. And that was the best, one of the best judgment to protect the doctor. After that judgment, there was a misconception that doctor can never be prosecuted under 304 or 304A. Dear friends, it is not so. The judgment in this case was, there was a 72-year-old guy who was in a terminal stage of cancer. And he felt breathlessness, got admitted in the hospital in Ludhiana. And due to non-availability of oxygen in the hospital, that patient died. Now, in that case, the judgment was given that non-availability of oxygen cannot be considered as gross negligence. It can be treated in tort. Compensation can be awarded to the patient or the relatives. But doctors can never be put in jail. Now, the judgment here is not important. But basically, Supreme Court had put forward three observations and given three guidelines in this case. And that is very important. The first observation Supreme Court has put in this case, that we have observed nowadays that the cases are in criminal law filed against physician and surgeon, that means doctors, are on rise. Every year they are on rise. And they have mentioned that most of the FIR which are filed against doctor are being filed either by the relatives of the patient who dies or by the constable level person, constable of police. And these two people do not have knowledge of any medical negligence. So they are filing cases out of emotion. They don't have any knowledge of medical negligence. And once case is filed against doctor, they have to go to seek the bail. And harassment starts. You have to go to seek the bail. You may get bail, you may not get bail. And next day, FIR will be filed against you. And all newspaper will print the FIR. So later on, you may be acquitted. There may not be any case against you on next day. But the name and fame which a doctor loses on filing the FIR is irreparable. That was the observation of Supreme Court. And that's why there is a need to protect doctor. The second observation which was put by Supreme Court, they said that most of the, there is, as doctors are into, you know, that Supreme Court has said that we are not telling that doctor can never be prosecuted. If there is definite negligence, then definitely doctor can be prosecuted, but not always. And they said that as doctors are into a noble profession, they cannot work under fear of law. No doctor can exert his level best under the fear of law. And that's why there is a need to protect doctor. That was the observation of Supreme Court. And they have observed that most of the criminal cases are filed by the patient or the relatives under criminal law to extort the money from the doctor, to pressurize the doctor to compensate them outside the court and to settle the case outside the court. So most of the cases are being filed to extort the money from the doctor. That was the observation of Supreme Court. And third observation Supreme Court gave, that a guideline must be formed to protect the doctor by state medical councils or Medical Council of India, in association with the government, state government or central government, to protect the doctor from such frivolous complaints. So these are the three observations given by Supreme Court. And three guidelines were given. The first guideline was given that no FIR can be filed against doctor if it is not associated with the expert opinion from the same kind of doctor. Suppose you are a gynecologist, and if some other gynecologist give in writing that this doctor is grossly negligent in the treatment, then only FIR can be filed. Otherwise, FIR cannot be filed. In absence of expert opinion, second guideline was given that if expert opinion is not there, and in most of the cases, no colleague will ever give guideline the report against the colleague. And that's why no FIR can be filed against doctor. But in absence of expert opinion, it is a duty of police officer to ask for unbiased opinion from the similar kind of doctor who are practicing in nearby government hospital. And their opinion must be taken that whether doctor is negligent or not. And only if that opinion comes, then only FIR can be filed against doctor. Now, for taking such kind of opinion, sometimes police officers take 6 months or 1 year. Sometimes we forget the case after 6 months, and suddenly police officer enters in our hospital that FIR is lodged against you, and we have come to take the action. So that kind of, so we must not be, away from the case. Whenever something happens, you should be vigil at least for 6 months or 1 year, or even after that 1 year, to know that what is going on, what kind of opinion the police are taking, from where they are taking the opinion. So that we must know. So we must be in touch with some police constable of the local police station. Third thing, police has said, this guideline has said that even if doctor is to be registered, FIR is to be filed, but doctor can never be arrested in a normal routine manner. They cannot apply handcuff to the doctor. They have to call the doctor, take the statement, tell doctor to appear in the court of law. But they cannot arrest a doctor in a normal routine manner in which some other criminals are being arrested. So these are the three guidelines which are given in Jacob Matthews. We have noted that even after this judgment of 2005 in Jacob Matthews case, many police officers do not have knowledge of this particular decision. And they don't follow the Supreme Court guideline. They say that law to alag hai, law mein aisa kahin nahi likha hai. They don't know the Supreme Court guideline. So it is my advice, humble advice, that every doctor should keep this judgment of Jacob Matthews versus State of Punjab in their consulting room. And whenever anything happens to your colleague or to yourself, at least show police officer that you cannot file FIR against me. And even if you want to file FIR, you must take opinion from the unbiased committee of nearby government hospital, from the similar kind of doctors. Now, the most important thing is that looking to these kind of things, in 2009, Justice Markande Kadzu and Justice Loda gave a very nice judgment in M. D'Souza versus Mohammed Ishfaq's case. And in that case, Justice Markande Kadzu categorically mentioned that many officers are not following the guidelines. And if any police officer does not follow the guideline given by Supreme Court in Jacob Matthews case, then that particular police officer can be punished. So that is the important thing. And that was a very nice judgment in which Justice Markande Kadzu said that law is a watchdog, not a bloodhound. So don't worry if you are reasonably careful. So you have to be reasonably careful. Nobody can file direct FIR if you are not unreasonable. So that is the message. Last but not least, in one of the case, it is said that 304 should never be applied against doctor. Even if for rash and negligent act, if there is death due to negligence, then 304A is to be applicable. Now, what is the difference? 304A is bailable. Nobody can arrest you. You can get bail as if it is your right. But in 304, it is non-bailable. So you can be arrested. You have to take anticipatory bail in anticipation or for arrest. So that is the basic difference. And many police officers are trying to pressurize the doctor by applying wrongfully 304 and trying to arrest them, trying to make them under fear. So this is the problem. So if you know law, if you know proper
the things, proper these judgments of Jacob Matthew, Suresh Gupta and Markande Katsu, this M. D'Souza versus Mohammed Ishfaq, you can definitely argue with the police officer. And even if after that, if they apply 304, you can directly go to High Court for quashing of FIR. And simultaneously, you can put stay on the FIR. So these are the things which we should keep in mind. Last but not least, whenever there is any apprehension of being criminally prosecuted, it is my humble request that you should be in touch with the police officer, one of the police officer. You should have good liaising with the local police station, and at least one of the police officer who is in touch with you should be in continuous touch with them, so that what is going on at police station level, you should know. And if there is a apprehension that they may prosecute under 304, then at least flee away and take a legal, proper legal advice from the advocate. You can take medical legal advice from the medical legal person. You can take advice from your seniors who can guide you in a proper manner. And you should do something to seek the anticipatory bail to avoid the arrest. So hope I have passed enough messages, and any query is welcome. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was quite informing and reassuring to us. Any questions?
I think Neetu, Dr. Paul wanted to ask one question, that if a patient is admitted in hospital and does not pay advance amount as displayed in hospital and has to be shifted elsewhere due to some complications, still refuses to pay hospital bill, can police complaint be lodged against him?
Madam, basically, whenever there is a question of recovery of bill, that is a civil case. And civil cases are never been entertained by police in routine, ma'am, in routine cases. Okay. Unless you have special relationship with the police, only then they will entertain you. Otherwise, they will always tell that this is a civil case. So paying and not paying bill is a civil case. And civil cases are not been filed in criminal law. So police will usually don't entertain such cases. But taking the help of police, you can definitely shift that patient to government hospital where they will not pay. But you cannot stop the treatment of the patient which you are doing for non-payment of bill.
Thank you, sir. Well justified point, sir.
Thank you. Now we'll move to our last lecture. And for this, I'll invite our chairperson, Dr. Prachi, who is a senior radiologist. Dr. Shraddha Khandelwal, she is a surgeon, few of the female surgeon we have in Jabalpur, and Dr. Sonal Richaria, who is the upcoming secretary of WDW. I would request Dr. Prachi to kindly introduce the speaker, Dr. Mukul Tiwari, sir.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I am highly honored to introduce Dr. Mukul Tiwari to all of you. Sir is a state president, IMA MP State 2019 and 20. He is also chairperson of IMA Standing Committee for Child Health. He was chairperson for Medical Legal Group IAP 2015 to 2017. He was editor-in-chief, Journal of India Medical Legal and Ethics Association 2013 till 2016. He was also president Adolescent Health Academy MP 2012 to 2014. He was member of IAP Publication House from 2014 to 2016. He was state coordinator of medicine and law program of IMA. He is also member of Central Council of IMA. Sir has written a very beautiful book on textbook of medical legal issues. And last but not the least, he is recipient of Dr. B.C. Roy Oration Award. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Prachi. And welcome all the participants and esteemed speakers. I think we are very, very late. So shall we proceed directly?
Yes, sir.
So I'll share a screen and I'll speak in very short, because our IMLIA conference, the conference of the Indian Medical Legal and Ethics Association, is also going on at the same time. And I have to be there. So please excuse me for being short. So I'll share. So written consent and record keeping. Documents are the property of hospital. On written request can be handed over within 72 hours to the patient or the relatives. There should be no corrections, manipulations in the documents when you are handing over. The confidentiality of patient should be maintained. So you release with the patient's consent, not without that. The handwriting should be legible, clean, correct, and complete. The record should be, the document should be chronological and comprehensive. Now, the first part is consent. So what is a valid consent? It should be voluntary, without pressure, by an adult of sound mind, not under intoxication, after explanation, reasonable understanding. The person should be of reasonable understanding. I mean, it should not be by misrepresentation or hiding facts. Informed and writing, preferably not implied or blanket. It should be in writing. And there should be witnesses, two from the hospital and two from the patient side. Preferably, it is usually seen that we just take the two witnesses from the patient side, but we don't take usually from the hospital side. We think that later on we can take if the need arises. As sometimes we do not take any witnesses at all. We just take the signature of the patient. What is informed consent? It's a voluntary decision made by a competent patient to receive a specific medical care, which is based on a reasonable understanding of the general nature and effect of the treatment, the alternatives, and the risk and the benefit involved. Now, the theoretically, what are the elements of a valid informed consent? The three elements are disclosure, that means to give information of the disease in a language which should be understood by the patient or relatives or both. Then the capacity, the person who's giving consent should be able to understand the information provided and come to a judgment. The person should be of sound mind. Third, the voluntariness. There should be no coercion used on the patient person giving consent. The disclosure of information, how much information we should disclose in the consenting process to the patient or the relatives. So many things you can see here, the condition, disorder, disease that the patient is suffering from, necessity for further testing, if there is possibility, the natural course of the condition and possible complications, consequences of non-treatment, treatment options available, potential risk and benefits of treatment options, duration and approximate cost of the treatment, expected outcome, and follow-up will be required. That should also be explained. In which conditions the consent is not necessary? In emergency, when the delay will be detrimental, or during a procedure, surgery, anaphylaxis. In a patient who does not have the capacity to take a decision and no other person is accompanying, then you can waive off this consent. Then consent in children. Consent for treatment must be obtained from a child's parent or legal guardian until they turn 14. Consent can be obtained from one or both parents, regardless of marriage status, unless a court order has been made which stipulates that one parent has sole responsibility. That means dispute among the parents, marital dispute or anything. For children in care, care means some agencies, foster care. The person or agency with parental responsibility can consent. then consent in young people. From the age of 14, a minor may be mature enough to give their own consent. It is considered. Medical and dental practitioners should assess whether they are capable of consenting, and if not, should seek the consent of their parent or guardian. If you want to be very safe medically legally, I will advise that if the child is below the age of 18, child or adolescent, young person, it is better to take the signature of the patient as well as the parents. A young person's valid consent cannot be overruled by their parents. From the age 16, the consent of a minor is generally viewed as sufficient. Sufficient, but as I told you, if you want to be very safe, below 18, take the signature of the young person as well as the parents. Above 18, no need. Then informed financial consent. It often happens that we just take the consent for the procedure, consent for the admission, but do not take consent for the expenditure involved. And later on, they sometimes allege that so much bill has come and we were not informed. We had no knowledge. So if possible, fee should be outlined well in advance of the procedure, and any expected additional costs, such as fee of the other professional used to undertake the treatment, should be available to the patient prior to their consent being obtained. And this should be in writing, that approximate expenditure will be like this. And if the need arises, the further expenditures may be taken. The implied versus written consent, as already discussed by the esteemed speakers, implied is a consent which is automatic, like when a child or a lady has come for vaccination. We don't have to take written consent. It is considered that the consent is there already. Or if a lady wants to undergo examination by a gynecologist, then the consent is implied. Then consent versus assent. This is mostly of theoretical nature, this terminology, assent. It is used for young people, young individuals who are not mature enough to give consent, below 18 years. And this is mostly used for research purposes, not for treatments. Then therapeutic privilege. If a doctor is of the opinion that certain information can seriously harm a patient's health, physical, mental, or emotional, he or she has the privilege to withhold such information. But it should be shared with close relatives. And in today's dangerous times, from the medical legal point of view, it is better that you share as much as possible. This was good for the old times. Don't too much use therapeutic privilege. Then the blanket consent. This is also one mistake the hospitals make, that only one time consent is taken and all the procedures which follow are done according to that blanket consent only. But this is wrong. For each separate procedure, take each separate consent. Then informed refusal. This also must be documented. Patient has the right of refusal, and we must respect that. We should not feel antagonized by the refusal. It is their right. But we must document the refusal. For example, in a child with varicella or chickenpox, the parents may want no treatment because of religious beliefs. Same in case of measles. So the doctor's duty is to explain the possible consequences of non-treatment and document their refusal. Dharma or Lama, discharge against medical advice or leave left against medical advice, they also fall into this category. And there's need to properly document Dharma or Lama in the case sheet with the signature of the patient or the guardian. Now, since we are short of times, I'll not go into the case scenarios. these are the famous cases. You can go see them afterwards in the literature. Now we come to the documents, the records. The records may be personal or impersonal. Personal for the patients and impersonal for research or statistics. They may be paper records or computerized records. Computerized records are considered quite valid now. And what should be the records for indoor TPR, BP charts, diet charts, intake, output, weight charts, daily records, change of intracaths, Ryle's tubes, catheters, proper consent, police information, consent refusal for postmortem, etc. Telephonic consultation with seniors should also be recorded. OPD prescription, OPD register, small chits should also be stored. Under treatment certificates, sick certificates, fitness certificates, referrals to other doctors, pathology lab, x-rays, sonography, CT, MRI. Referrals should also be stored. Then chronological order of progress of disease and treatment given, monitoring of vitals, pulse, BP, RR, and temperature in diabetics, monitoring of blood sugar levels, continuous monitoring data in ICU patients, pathological tests, when ordered, and their results, X-ray reports, USG, CT, when ordered, and their results. Pre-operative treatment or preparation, this should also be documented and stored. Aimed at the pre-operative treatment aimed at avoiding untoward incidents during procedure operation. For example, atropine to avoid vagal shock, or to avoid aspiration during anesthesia by keeping the patient still. Details of invasive procedure or surgery or anesthesia given, post-procedure or post-operative treatment. In case of death, in chronological order, patient's deterioration noticed, measures taken, and progression of deterioration despite treatment. Now, this is often disputed by the doctors that when the patient is serious, how can we go on making records at the same time? So you can make the records, or if you have a team, you can assign one person to make the records, you can sign it. Or if the emergency is of a short duration, you can record afterwards, maybe after half an hour or 1 hour. In the meanwhile, you can just make small notes and you will remember what you have given. Now, how long to maintain the records? OPD records, 3 years. Inpatient, 5 years. Children, 21 years. MLC, 30 years. Mentally retarded forever till the person is practicing. From income tax point of view, for 7 years. As per Code of Medical Ethics, April 2002, for 3 years again. As said here, that in medical legal cases, 30 years. So if you are expecting any problem with any patient, better to keep the records, even after 3 years, 5 years, even if the patient has not gone to the court. All difficult cases maintain their records for 30 years, 25 years, 20 years at least. Guidelines to destroy records, give a public notice in one English and one vernacular newspaper with a time limit of usually 1 month from the date of publication. Anyone who wants the relevant paper can come and take a copy. After 1 month, you can destroy the record, but save the record in cases where litigation is going on or expected, mentally ill or retarded patients. That's all. So I'll finish here. This again a case scenario. We'll not go into this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for being
thank you, sir. Thank you, sir, for very informative lecture. And I'm highly privileged to introduce you, sir, because just I'll take a moment. I also belong to the same city of Gwalior, and your clinic is just near my home in Balwant Nagar.
Okay. Thank you so much.
And my husband was your junior.
I know.
Yes, sir.
I know him very well. Thank you so much.
Your lecture was very informative, and thank you so much, sir.
Thanks.
Thank you, sir. There were few questions which were asked by audience. I'm citing two questions which were asked by Dr. Atul Sule. He's a practicing general surgeon. His first question is minimum qualification to perform laparoscopic tubal ligation. Many doctors in government services are forced to do LTT despite being of various different subspecialty. Many general surgeons are also doing it.
This question is to whom?
Anyone who wants to answer, Dr. Geetan? I think yeah, Dr. Geetan sir is a practicing.
Yes.
MBBS is the qualification required to do tubal ligation operation. So for laparoscopic, MBBS should take training, and he should be in condition to prove in the court of law that he has taken training and enough experience to do tubal ligation.
Okay, sir. So someone...
I want to add why there is a confusion, because if you want to register that tubal ligation procedure as a family planning procedure to avail some government benefits, then you have to register yourself with the government panel. And to register with the government panel, they require a specific training. Like in Gujarat, there was a norm that you have to take training of, say, 3 months under the
15 days only.
Certain centers. So that in our time, it was like you must be well trained at that time, but we were told to have 3 months training in Baroda. So there were various norms as per the government of circular at that point of time. But otherwise, as a gynec procedure, you can always do it, as Gitendra has rightly said.
The second question which he asked was, can a general surgeon of experience of more than 20 years perform onco surgery and vascular surgery? I would like to you to answer, sir, Dr. Hitesh.
As far as the operations are concerned, the first thing is medical council has not specifically prohibited anybody from doing anything. Any MBBS doctor can practice. But the point is, if you want to do something, you have to prove that you have this much experience, or you have the enough experience to do that particular procedure on a patient. Now, the best example of the training is our post-graduation. If you do post-graduation from a particular medical council recognized college, then that itself is a demonstration of your training in that particular field. Now, if you do not have that particular training and still you want to do something, then you have to prove to the court, if something goes wrong, that you had enough training and you have not done any experience on the patient. So that you should be in a position to do. That is first thing which court will see at the time of the case is filed. Second thing is the standard practice. What is the standard practice in your particular area? That will be seen by the court while judging a negligence. Now, say in the state, in a place like Mumbai, we have specialists for all the specialty. So if you do not involve the specialist, suppose a surgeon is doing cesarean operation, or the general surgeon is doing the HIFI cancer surgery, then the question will be asked why the person was not referred to a particular surgeon. In that case, you should have a negative consent, or you should have a consent from the patient that you have given this information to the patient and still patient wanted to go ahead with you and not with anybody. But if you are doing the same thing in an area where only general surgeon is taking care of all kind of surgeries, then you are justified. So you have to also prove that what is the general practice in the area where you are practicing. So there are many parameters. There is no rule of thumb. And second thing is, there is no specific prohibition that you can't do it. It depends on case to case basis.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all the speakers for sparing your time and giving such valuable information. Actually, I think Dr. Sangeeta Srivastava, madam, she had an emergency call of twin delivery. That is why she is not here. What we can do, being in an emergency branch, it's like that. She has been preparing for this event for like past 15 days and was so excited, more than me. I'm the secretary, but she does most of the work. So thank you, everyone. We look forward that we'll have more of medico-legal conference and more participation from doctors. As a doctor, I feel that we really need to change ourselves and take it seriously. We have started...
No, I will like to say a few things.
Yes, sir.
See, I don't think that Dr. Mukul Tiwari sir is now there on this. He has left. But two, three things I will like to specify that in India, we are following real and valid consent. We are not following informed consent. So whatever was told in the lecture that what is informed consent and everything. So we are not supposed to follow informed consent in India. In the decision of Samira Kohli versus Dr. Prabha Manchanda, the Supreme Court three-judge bench has categorically mentioned that in India, we should follow real and valid consent. And there is a vast difference in between real and valid consent and informed consent. Because in informed consent, it becomes the duty of doctor to inform everything to the patient. But in real and valid consent, it is a bilateral thing. Patient as well as doctor, both have duty to know because it is a contract as per real and valid. And second thing, which was mentioned, that in case of pediatric cases, you should take consent of legal guardian. Word was used as legal guardian. See, there is no such provision. The word used is guardian. There is vast difference in between guardian and legal guardian. Who is legal guardian? That will be decided by court of law. An individual cannot. So guardian means who is guarding somebody. So suppose some minor patient has been admitted in your hospital of 16 years. Now she is a girl and she is associated with the rector of the hospital, in charge of the hostel where she is staying. So that in charge of the hostel automatically become the guardian. So guardian and legal guardian, there is vast difference. So we should not use the word legal guardian. Basically, consent can be taken from the guardian who is guarding. So anybody who is associating with the patient above the age of 18 years with sane mind can become the guardian and can give consent. So these are the two things which we should clear in our mind. That's what.
Thank you, sir. Telling us that real and valid consent is a different thing. You have made our job a little easier that in India we can practice that. And so I think we would conclude. Anyone who wants to ask a question or add something to it is welcome. No, thank you. We got delayed and you spared all these extra minutes for us, all the speakers and the chairperson. Thank you very much.